Hello students, welcome back to the economics class of plus 2 standard. As we have already started lesson number 12, money and banking. In this, yesterday we have discussed the topic money and its kinds. Today we will start with the new topic functions of money, static and dynamic functions of money and supply of money. First of all, we will discuss some important key terms related to this topic. First one is standard of deferred payments, high powered money and liquidity. Let's understand the meaning of standard of deferred payments. When we make the payments in future, that is known as standard of deferred payments. Like when we use the postpaid bills or bills of exchange and we purchase the commodities in the current date and make the payment for the same commodity in future. That is known as standard of deferred payments. The best examples for the standard of deferred payments, that is postpaid bills are there, salaries are there, pension it is there, wages are there. All these are the examples of standard of deferred payments. So standard of deferred payments refers to those payments which are to be made in future. High powered money, currency notes like rupees 50, rupees 100, rupees 500, rupees 2000, etc. plus coins of different denominations like 50 paisa coin, rupees 10 coin, rupees 5 coin in circulation is high powered money. As stated earlier, that high powered money refers to the total monetary liability of the monetary authorities, that is Reserve Bank of India or the central government of the country. Liquidity means when we can exchange any asset in the form of cash, or simply cash you can say, that is a liquidity. So liquidity means the state of being liquid or the ability to easily turn any asset or investment into cash. Like when I will sell this refrigerator in the market, I will get money in the form of cash, that is a liquidity. But I will not get the full amount for this refrigerator as it is a second hand, so I will get the less amount for the sale of this product. In the same way, for selling of a house, I will get the money, that is in terms of liquidity. Next one is functions of money. There are different functions of money. First one is primary functions, secondary functions and contingent functions. Under the primary functions, there is a medium of exchange, unit of account. Under the secondary function, there is a standard of deferred payments, store of value, transfer of value. Under the contingent functions, measurement of national income, distribution of national income, maximization of satisfaction, basis of credit and productivity of capital. First one is we will discuss primary functions. Medium of exchange, we can measure the wages in the form of money and can measure the value of goods, like a piece of cloth worth rupees 400, 1 kg rice, its value it is equals to rupees 100. In the same way, for any type of currency, we can exchange the goods for that currency. So advantages for the primary functions of money, that is it overcomes the difficulties of barter system of exchange. As in the barter system of exchange, you know that there is no role of money. Only commodities are exchanged with the other commodities. And there is a difficulty to value the commodities, because sometimes one person is having costlier goods and other person is having cheaper goods. And they have to exchange these goods because of only demand. So it increases the ease of trade. With the measurement of the value in terms of money, it is easy for the persons to trade with the other persons. It allows freedom of choice, as every person can buy goods of his choice from the people who offer him the best bargain. With the help of money, we can purchase any commodity from the market without waiting for the person who is having the same commodity that we want to purchase. Unit of account or the measure of value. Suppose if we pay rupees 5 for a fountain pen, we have a measure of value in terms of basic units of account, that is rupees. So fountain pen can be exchanged for rupees 5. We use the other units of measure, like kilograms are there, liters are there, meters are there, centimeters are there. So all these are used to measure the value of a commodity. Now next one is, here you can see that there is a cup of coffee. That is, firstly it was of rupees 0.05, with the change of time its rupees increased from $0.05 to $0.15 for one cup of coffee, then $1.50 for one cup of coffee, and now the value of one cup of coffee, it is $3.5. So in this way we can measure the value of the product in terms of money. So for measuring value of a commodity, we take money as a unit of account. So money serves as a unit of measurement in terms of which the value of all kinds of goods and services are measured and expressed. When we express the value of commodity in terms of money, it is known as price. Price can be in any currency, like in India it's in rupees, and in USA it is in dollars, pounds in Britain, rupiah in Pakistan, dinar in Kuwait. So in this way we can measure the values of the commodities and services in terms of money. Secondary functions: standard of deferred payments, pensions, principals and interest on the debt and salaries and postpaid bills are there, bills of exchange are there. All these are the examples of deferred payments. Money is preferred as a standard of deferred payments because its value remains stable over time. What is the value of rupees 10 today? The same note, if we will use after 5 years in the market to purchase the commodity worth rupees 10, we will get the commodity in exchange of the same 10 rupee note. But if we are having any kind of vegetable or any kind of piece of cloth, any kind of dress it is there, or any refrigerator or car it is there, if we will sell these products after a few years in the market, we will not get the same price. Its value, it will be down. Other goods like milk, vegetable, eatables, etc. are perishable commodities, means non-durable commodities. Their values get depleted over time. So deferred payments refers to those payments which are to be made in future. Advantages of the deferred payments: it has facilitated borrowings and lending activities. It has led to creation of financial institutions like banks and finance companies. Whatever surplus it is left with us in the form of money, we can deposit in the banks and we can get the interest also from the banks. In the same way, if we need the finance, we can borrow from the banks by paying the rate of interest according to the bank norms. Next one is secondary functions: store of value. Money serves as a store of value. Wealth can be stored in the form of assets, like cars are there, machines are there, computers, refrigerator, compressor, etc. as well. But money is the best form of holding assets because money is the most liquid form of all assets, as storing of asset is not an easy task, and the value of assets over time it will be reduced because of any reason, because of change in model, color, design and technology, etc. Next one is liquidity. Liquidity means your emergency savings account or the cash lying with you that you can use in case of any kind of financial crisis. So liquidity means a state of being liquid or ability to easily turn the assets or the investment into cash. Like I am having the fixed deposits, and before the maturity date I am having a financial crisis. In order to meet or solve these financial crises, I can use this fixed deposits before the maturity date and transfer these into the liquid assets, like I can get the cash from the banks. So people normally keep a part of their wealth in the form of money because savings in terms of goods is very difficult. Advantages: it can easily exchange for goods at all times. When we are having money, we can purchase any commodity or services from the market according to our requirement. It comes in convenient denominations. For example, there are different denominations of Indian currency notes, like rupees 10, rupees 20, rupees 50, rupees 100 note is there, rupees 200 are there, rupees 500 are there, and rupees 2000 there in India. So there are different denominations of the currency also there, with which it's easy for us to purchase the commodity from the market. Transfer of value: it is difficult to transfer the fixed assets from one place to another place, but it is easy to transfer the money from one place to another place. Moreover, it occupies space, and it occupies also space but lesser. It is difficult to transfer fixed assets like machinery, refrigerator, furniture, oil fillers, etc. from one place to another. However, by converting them into money, their value can easily be transferred from one place to another. So money serves as a transfer of value. People can purchase immovable property at any place with money. People can loan out or deposit their surplus money in the banks and get the rate of interest from the banks. And people can loan out their surplus value and earn interest income in any part of the country and abroad also. Money facilitates the process of investment and growth in the economy. Contingent functions, measurement of national income. The values of various goods and services, like goods and services like cars, furniture, dresses, tools, machines, etc., and services like doctors, engineers, teachers, cobblers, barber, chartered accountant, etc., produced in an economy, can be expressed in terms of money. So money is helpful in measuring the national income for all those goods and services that are produced in an economy within a particular year at a particular price, which is not possible in the barter system. Distribution of national income. Whenever any commodities or final output it is there in the country in the form of goods and services that is jointly produced by a large number of people like workers, landowners, capitalists and entrepreneurs, and the profit from the production of these goods and services that should be distributed among all the that can be distributed among all the members of the economy. So national income has to be distributed among them. Money helps in the distribution of national product through a system of wage, rent, interest and profit, even taxes also, which are expressed in terms of money. Maximization of satisfaction. Money helps the consumer and producers to maximize their benefits. A consumer maximizes satisfaction by looking at the prices. If the prices are cheaper and the commodity is also the best one, this will maximize the satisfaction of the consumer, because the consumer always seeking for the cheap and best commodities. Similarly, a producer maximizes profit by equating the marginal productivity of a factor per unit increase in the production and the profit from the per unit of production. That is the goal of the producer. Now, next one is basis of credit. Credit instruments like checks, drafts, bills of exchange cannot be used without the existence of money. Because if we are not having any money in our saving accounts or the current accounts, what is the use of these checks and drafts and bills of exchange? You may not be able to issue a check to somebody unless you have some money in your account with the banks. Contingent functions. Productivity of capital. Money increases the productivity of capital as it is the most liquid type of capital. It can be put into any use. If I want to start a business with the help of money, I can purchase the machinery with the help of money. I can purchase the land with this help of money. I can pay the wages to the laborers. I can make the payment for the purchase of the raw material also. So it is because of the liquidity of money that capital can be easily transferred from the less productive uses to the more productive uses. It is because of this function that capital has become most mobile during recent times. Bearer of options. Bearer of option means that what is the purchasing power of a man. Man can purchase any commodity in the world if he is having sufficient money to purchase it. If I am having a money that I can purchase an aeroplane, so it means that I am the bearer of the option. So money serves as a bearer of the option. Static function of money. Functions of money like medium of exchange, measure of value, store of value and measures of deferred payments are all the static functions of money. As you know that medium of exchange, it is the function of primary function of money. We can make the payments for the purchase of the commodities. Measure of value means we can measure the value of any commodity in terms of money. Store of value means when we store the purchase the assets from the market and store them for the future use. And measures of deferred payments means when we make the payments for any purchase of commodity in future. So these are the static functions of money. These functions are also known as technical or passive functions of money. These functions help to regulate the economic system. They do not stimulate the system to a higher level of growth and development. Important dynamic functions of money are: money influences the general price level, which in turn affects and encourages or discourages the production and welfare of the society. Price level increases with the increase in money supply. Means when the production of goods and services in the economy it is lesser, and money in the household hands, it is more. Then there is an inflationary condition arises in the economy. And with the decrease in the money or with the decrease in the money supply, then there is deflationary condition arise in the economy. Money directs idle resources into productive channels. Like within a factory, there are some machines lying idle. If I am having the money, I will purchase that machine or that factory, and I can use those machines and factories for the production process. People keep their savings in the form of bank deposits to earn interest income also. In the same way, banks in turn lend this money that is deposited by the people in the banks in their saving accounts or in the form of time deposits, that is fixed deposit or recurring deposits are there, to the businessman. From these deposited money by the people in the banks further lend this money to the businessman for the investment in the economy. Money has also its great influence on the economic activity by changing interest rates. With the higher interest rates, the people will borrow less from the banks and there is a contraction of money supply in the economy. And if the government or the RBI or commercial banks will pay higher rate of interest on the deposits, that is by the people will save more in order to get more rate of interest. As rate of interest falls with an increase in money supply and the rises when supply of money falls. Supply of money. Supply of money is defined as total stock of all the forms of money, that is of paper money, coins and demand deposits at bank, which are held by the public at a particular point of time. Two points need to be noted in this connection. First one is supply of money is a stock variable, not a flow variable, because it is related to a point of time, not to a period of time. Supply of money, if extra money that is printed with the banks, lying with the banks only, and it is not in circulation, and when there is a demand for more money, then the banks or the RBI can increase the money supply in the economy by lowering the rate of interest and by lowering the imposition of the taxes on the income. Remember, supply of money should not be confused with the supply of a commodity as defined in microeconomics. Supply of money. Second stock of money always refers to the stock of money held by the public, not the money that is not in circulation and only lying idle with the government or the RBI. The stock of money with the government or RBI banking system is not included in the supply of money as it does not come into the circulation in the country. Here the term public includes all economic units like household firms, local authorities, non-banking financial institutions, etc., except producers of money. Producer of money means RBI. Supply of money. Central government, RBI and all banks which accept demand deposits. Demand deposits means that is saving accounts and current accounts are the producers of money. The rationale behind considering money supply as held by the public is to separate the producers of money from those who use money to fulfill their demand for money. Components or the elements of money supply. First one is money supply is composed of the following two elements. First is currency with the public and demand deposits in the bank in the form of current account and in the form of saving accounts. First one is currency with the public. In order to arrive at the total currency with the public in India, we add the following items. Currency notes in circulation issued by the RBI and the number of rupee notes and coins in circulation and small coins in circulation. It is worth noting here that cash reserves with the banks, that is CRR, has to be deducted from the value of the above three items of the currency in order to arrive at the total currency with the public. We will calculate only that currency that is in circulation in the economy, not that currency that is lying with the central bank or the RBI. This is because cash reserves with the banks must remain with them only and cannot be used for making payments for the goods and services or by any commercial banks transactions. In short, currency with the public, it is equal to notes in circulation plus rupee notes and coins plus small coins minus cash with the banks. Demand deposits at the banks. Demand deposits like saving accounts and the current accounts are other components of the money supply. Demand deposits with the banks are called bank money also. Demand deposits in the banks refers to those deposits which are payable on demand, and this can be possible only through checks. Only checks these deposits can be transferred to the other for making payments from whom the goods and services has been purchased. These checks make these demand deposits as a medium of exchange and therefore make them to serve as money. Demand deposits are created when people deposit money with banks. More importantly, banks themselves create deposits when they give loans to the businessmen and other people. Further, there are interbanking claims also, that is claim of one bank against the other. The entire claim do not constitute a part of money supply, as they do not belong to the public. Only net demand deposits instead of gross demand deposits of commercial banks are taken as a part of money supply. Net demand deposits, that the deposits with the commercial bank, not with the RBI. The money supply is composed of currency held by the public, and demand deposits with banks. Symbolically, money supply it is equals to total money in circulation plus demand deposits. Determinants of money supply. The two important determinants of money supply are, first one is amounts of high powered money plus size of money multiplier. High powered money like currency, standard currency with different denominations, currency notes like rupees 100, rupees 50, rupees 500, rupees 2000. As stated earlier, high powered money refers to the total monetary liability of the monetary authorities, RBI, central government of India of the country. Determinants of money supply. It consists of money, currency, notes and coins in circulation with the public, and cash reserves of commercial banks, and deposits held by the government of India and the commercial bank with RBI. These are the claims which general public or the government or the banks have on RBI, and hence are considered to be the liability of RBI. Next one is, a part of the currency that is issued is held by the public, which is denoted by C. That is, a C means the total money in circulation, and a part is held by the banks as reserves, which is denoted by R. So determinants of money supply, high powered money, it is equals to the summation of total money supply in circulation plus reserves with the banks, that is commercial banks or RBI, and other deposits like fixed deposits, demand deposits, time deposits, etc. So C here is the total currency in circulation, R is the currency with the banks only, and OD is the other deposits, and H is the high powered money. So high powered money is the summation of all these components. The size of multiplier. Commercial banks and or the producers of demand deposits, which are a part of money supply, it is against cash reserves that banks are able to create a multiple expansion of the demand deposits. This multiple is called the money multiplier. The relationship between money supply and high powered money, that is C plus R, total money supply in circulation plus money with the banks, is determined by the money multiplier. The money multiplier, where M is the money multiplier, small m, it is the ratio of total money supply divided by the high powered money, that is M is equal to M upon H. Suppose money multiplier it is 2 and high powered money given it is 3000. When we will multiply money multiplier with the high powered money, we will get the 6000. So 6000 is the total money in circulation in the economy, where small m is the money multiplier, capital M is the total money supply, and H is the high powered money. Measures of money supply. RBI has given 4 measures of money supply. First one is M1, M2, M3 and M4. Let's discuss what is there in M4. M4 is the summation of total money supply in circulation plus demand deposits like saving accounts and current accounts, and other deposits like time deposits. Only the net demand deposits of banks are included in money supply, because the part of demand deposits that represents interbank deposits held by one bank with the other does not constitute demand deposits, that is held by the public. Measures of money supply. Other demand deposits means other deposits with the RBI. These are the deposits held by the RBI of all economic units except the government. All economic units means like entrepreneurs are there, households are there, firms are there, except government and banks. Other deposits include demand deposits of public, that is financial institutions like IDBI, foreign central bank and the governments, the IMF, the World Bank, etc. M2, what is there in M2? M1 means all the components of M1, that is total money supply in circulation plus saving deposit with the post offices will give you the M2 money supply. Under the M3 money supply, M1 plus net time deposits of the commercial banks. As you can see here, we have calculated M1 as total money supply in circulation, demand deposits and other deposits. Next one is M4. M4, it is equals to M3. What is there in M3? M1 plus net time deposits of the commercial banks. So M3 plus total deposits with post offices excluding national saving certificates. National saving certificates are not included in M4 money supply. Note, M3 measures of money supply is known as aggregate monetary resources of the country, as it covers M1, that is total money supply in the circulation, plus demand deposits and other deposits and net time deposits of the commercial banks. In broader concept of money supply compared to M1 and M2. Students, hope you have understood the topic. Now it's time to note down the homework. Question number 1 is, write the key terms for the following with examples like standard of deferred payments, high powered money. Question number 2 is, discuss the primary, secondary and contingent functions of money. And students, please go through the YouTube links also for more clarity, and hope you all will write these notes in your copies for better learning. Thank you for listening, students.